And picking up the torch as the campaign chairman of the American Foundation for AIDS Research.
Use red, nobody's dead.
We'll have red products, we'll have red phones.
Last year we raised over a million, we were very happy, and now it's grown immeasurably over the last year.
Members of the public often notice the celebrities who have suddenly and inexplicably become experts on public health. We have turned these kinds of stars into authorities on things way beyond their own training and their own knowledge.
Science, with its harsh efforts at total objectivity, can actually hold within its ways of operating the seeds of its own failure.
At least they should open up the field to people with other theories, because their own has proven to be such a resounding failure.
In science, we cannot have any prejudice. The fact that AIDS started in the gay community has nothing to do with the sexual preferences that this group of people have.
Why do they not acknowledge the virtual immunity of women in the United States and Europe and developed countries?
I think that we've been basically chasing the wrong paradigm for the last 20 years, and I'm afraid to say that it doesn't look like that's going to change anytime soon.
They'll backtrack a little bit, but they'll never give HIV up.
We should continue as combatively as we can to speak out and shake up the dogma at all levels.
The next generation of younger doctors is going to now be able to see all the information before them.
We are told that the most lethal epidemic of the last 100 years is AIDS. That around the world, you hear figures as high as 250 million people could be infected. Millions dying. In South Africa alone, 5 million infected. What is the truth of this? We're also told that you need the drugs. They'll put time on your side. Without them, you're absolutely going to die. We're told that once you're infected, it's going to be there forever. You can't get rid of it. Is that the truth? We're also told that we need an antibody test. That's the only way to determine, do we have AIDS? Is that factual? I'm Gary Nall. I'd like to welcome you to a special program, a program that will look at AIDS from a different point of view.
The old paradigm in science is, first, you find the cause, and then you treat the cause. Well, with AIDS, we have violated both.
Not a single retrovirus has been ever demonstrated to be responsible for any single human disease, and certainly not killing anybody.
To think that the collapse of the human immune system, which is a very sophisticated system that's built up over millions of years, just started happening in 1980? I'm sorry, this is science fiction.
Dr. David Raznick is one of the developers of protease inhibitors, part of the antiretroviral drug treatment commonly used to treat AIDS patients. Over the past 26 years, Dr. Raznick has done extensive research on the subject of HIV and AIDS.
The best evidence against the HIV hypothesis is that there is no evidence for it. In the vast scientific medical literature, over 100,000 journals published so far on HIV/AIDS, we cannot find anywhere in this vast literature the evidence that HIV causes AIDS, that AIDS is a contagious disease, or that it even sexually transmitted. We don't know the names of these people who have done this work. For example, if this had been shown that AIDS is caused by HIV, we should know who these benefactors of humanity are by name. These would be candidates for the Nobel Prize.
In 1983, a French virologist named Luc Montagnier published a paper in which he hypothesized that a virus he had isolated was the cause of the mysterious new syndrome affecting gay men known as acquired immune deficiency syndrome, or AIDS. 1 year later, Dr. Robert Gallo at the National Cancer Institute made world headlines after he claimed he had discovered the virus that causes AIDS using a sample he had borrowed from Luc Montagnier.
Dr. Gallo also claimed that he had devised a test for the virus and could reproduce it in the large quantities needed for further research. The worldwide convention that HIV is the cause of AIDS dates from this moment. More than 20 years ago, Dr. Peter Duisberg, a noted molecular biologist, world-renowned virologist, and UCLA professor, was one of the few voices in the world of AIDS dissidents. Around 1987, he began asking a question that seemed like heresy in its day. Was it possible that the scientists were all wrong when they equated HIV with AIDS?
I know Gallo, and Gallo is not a bad virologist. He would have found a virus that is there at concentrations where it could cause a disease. But Gallo proved to the scientific world with this what proved to be a nearly a scandal in the scientific history. He claimed the virus from a colleague as his own. He proved that it was very, very difficult, even for an excellent laboratory as Gallo was operating it at the NIH, to isolate a virus from an AIDS patient.
There has never been viremia, which means the blood flooded with whole cell-free infectious viruses. If HIV were actually doing anything, making people sick, there would indeed be viremia, meaning millions of whole viruses per milliliter of plasma. In fact, nobody has ever observed even one of them.
Some of the most vocal critics of the HIV equals AIDS hypothesis are a group of Australian researchers led by Dr. Eleni Papadopoulos-Eliopoulos. In their breakthrough report, the scientists raised serious questions about the accuracy of HIV antibody tests, and more importantly, the very relationship of HIV to AIDS. In fact, they questioned whether HIV has ever been isolated.
As far as we're concerned, if one goes through all the HIV literature which exists to date, I think one will find it bold and incredible to still believe that there is proof for the existence of HIV. When a particle looks like a retrovirus, you have to isolate it, then put it in another culture, show that the cells in the secondary culture produce particles exactly like the particles from which they originated. But the two particles from the two cultures are exactly the same can be shown only by determining their constituent proteins and RNA. So isolation is extremely important to prove that the particle is a retrovirus.
From the very start, the hypothesis that the hypothetical HIV was destroying a subfamily of human lymphocytes was making no scientific sense whatsoever, because retroviruses are fundamentally not cytolytic, as we say in medicine. They are not destroying the cells they infect. They coexist with them.
Nobody can find free infectious HIV virus in a human being. That is why they have to resort to looking for antibodies to HIV in a person. That is one of the biggest flaws in the HIV hypothesis, that antibodies, which are a sign of immunity, you should be happy that you have antibodies. It means that you are now immune. And yet with AIDS, we have antibodies as a predictor or an indicator of AIDS and future death.
Retroviruses don't really have much power to cause harm. We have studied retroviruses, but HIV in particular has never been clearly defined in terms of its genetic structure and its molecular structure. And what I mean by that is that you can try to determine the genetic sequence of HIV from one person and compare it to another person, or even different viruses in the same person's body, and you'll find that there are huge variations in their genetic sequences. And now we're starting to talk about different strains and mutations and all this stuff. What that really means is that nobody's really sure exactly what HIV is, what the exact genetic sequence is.
The long latent period is an unambiguous indication that this virus cannot be the cause of AIDS. Unless, of course, that's what you always say in science, unless we find totally new things, radically new properties in HIV that we haven't found in any other virus or in any other retrovirus. But look at this. Here we have books like this on retroviruses. We have an encyclopedic knowledge on retroviruses accumulated in the last 20 or 30 years. We know hundreds and thousands of them, and so well, better than any other virus. And not one of them does that. There's no way that this virus could have a mystery that isn't in any of these books yet.
If you really sit down and look at HIV research and all the findings that have been presented over the years, you still find no demonstrable qualitative or quantitative activity. Those are scientific words that basically mean we can't find either enough of the type of the virus or enough of it to explain what we then see with the decline of the immune system. There is no real relationship if you really get down to brass tacks and look at the fine details, which I and others have done, between the amount of HIV in a person's system and whether they get sick or not, or how fast they get sick.
HIV has never been isolated directly from one single AIDS patient. Some pictures, some electron microscope pictures were taken in cell cultures, highly contaminated with a variety of other cells just to make sure that some retroviruses would be found in them. But this was never demonstrated as originating from a single AIDS patient.
There is this notion that HIV jumped from a chimpanzee to a human sometime in the 40s or 50s in Africa. Problem is, they've never been able to isolate that previous strain in the chimpanzee. Where is the pre-human version of HIV? It ain't there. They cannot find any animal carrier or any animal reservoir for HIV in the wild. It seems to have been in humans quite some time. And as a matter of fact, Jonas Salk, a very famous scientist who developed the polio vaccine, told me and others in 1994 or 95, before he passed away, that he probably thinks that HIV was 900 years old in humans, and other researchers have basically postulated even longer.
California microbiologist Dr. Curry Mullis was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1993 for his development of one of the most widely used current techniques in molecular biology today, the PCR, or polymerase chain reaction. This revolutionary technique allows scientists to take a sample containing a very minute amount of DNA and replicate that DNA sequence until there are many copies. One of the first applications of PCR was to analyze human tissue for the presence of HIV. PCR is commonly used in medical and biological research labs for the detection of virus culture in infectious persons.
The people that are AIDS researchers now are getting neurotic. If you ask them any questions. There was a time when I first started asking questions, all I wanted was, where are the papers? Just tell me the papers that you read that convinced you that HIV was the cause of AIDS, because I need to reference those papers in some of the, I was working on a test for HIV with PCR, and I needed to write a little report to the NIH and say, here's the progress we've made. And the first line of it was, HIV is the probable cause of AIDS. And I thought that was true. This is before I got involved. And I said, what's the reference for that quote? And I looked for it for about 2 or 3 years and I never could find it. And by the end of 2 years, I'd ask everybody at every meeting that I'd gone to that talked about AIDS, I'd ask, you know, I'd look through every computer database. There is no reference. There is nobody who should get credit for that statement. Now that's a pretty weird situation in science, where getting credit for a discovery is the most important thing in your life as a scientist.
It's not just Peter Duisberg or some outsiders who criticize the failure of our war against AIDS. It's the orthodoxy itself. They advertise they have not saved one single life. That means, in conventional scientific logic, there could very well be something profoundly wrong with the basic hypothesis, with the basic approach that we use against AIDS.
It wasn't a plot, it wasn't even greed or anything like that. It was a mistake in certain circumstances that happened. But the failure has been that science failed to correct that error. Subsequently, it's had plenty of opportunity to do that. but the whole kind of bandwagon that got rolling.
This year, an estimated 40,000 individuals in the United States and almost 6 million people worldwide will become infected with HIV.
With all the feeling associated with it, the compassion for AIDS patients, the fear of what was happening as this purported virus was thought to be spreading sexually in the world's populations, that feeling, that emotion, stopped science from following its normal checks and balances and putting right this fundamental mistake.
After 20 years of research, with nothing on the vaccine horizon, pretty inconsistent treatments, and no actual mechanism by which we are to understand this tiny little piece of genetic material causes the complete collapse of the immune system, I think it's high time that we started looking at other alternatives. Not to say that HIV has nothing to do with AIDS, but there probably is something going on, and some of the biggest minds in AIDS science are beginning to suspect this as well.
This is Stonewall. This is where it began. June 28, 1969. 8 New York City police officers showed up here. They came to do what they had done dozens of times: arrest and harass gays. A major confrontation ensued. Within 2 hours, there were nearly 2,000 gays in the street and 400 New York City police. The New York City police realized that it could no longer arbitrarily and capriciously harass and attack individuals who were simply choosing to honor their own lifestyle. This was the beginning of gay liberation. It was also the beginning of the sexual revolution within the gay community. And within the next few years, hundreds of clubs like Stonewall would open throughout New York, Los Angeles, and San Francisco.
From the mid-1970s until 1984, when the so-called official cause of AIDS was announced to the world, many individuals in the gay community were suffering from a unique form of diseases that baffled scientists. The original theory was that living an unhealthy lifestyle, including the use of poppers or amine nitrate, and unsafe anal intercourse were the causes of AIDS.
After years of struggling for that their sexual predisposition to be accepted by society, with the whole gay lib movement and everything that that stood for, here was what was at first called a gay plague by the US administration in the early 80s. They were more or less saying, we wash our hands of this. And that presented a very big threat to these guys, because they knew that their friends were dying, that there was a genuine new syndrome there, and the government was seemingly not showing much interest.
The name was suggested for that disease, to name it gay-related immune deficiency, GRID. So it was strictly associated with the fact that these 5 initial patients were homosexuals. That created an extremely passionate reaction from the gay community that regarded as totally intolerable that such a discrimination was pointing at their lifestyle and the disease.
AIDS was first identified among gay men in 1981 who practiced certain lifestyle behaviors. They, according to the New York Times, on July 3rd, 1981, tended to have upwards of 2,000 sexual contacts a year, and used a lot of aphrodisiacal drugs, including poppers, amyl nitrite, a very dangerous substance that gay men had been inhaling in epidemic proportions since the early 1970s. And with regard to the sexual activity, you don't need to be moralistic to say that, you know, gosh, you have 2,000 sex partners a year, you develop a laundry list of infectious diseases, venereal diseases, that can do a lot of damage over the long term to your immune system. Doctors and scientists looking at this phenomenon early on said, gosh, they do a lot of drugs, they have a laundry list of venereal diseases. The combination of these factors might well be enough to knock their immune systems for a real loop.
In addition to the drug use and anal intercourse, gay men suffered from AIDS typically practiced other immune suppressive habits such as drinking and smoking, intravenous drug use, very unhealthy diets, and a gross lack of sleep. This combination of hazardous lifestyle choices is often referred to as fast tracking. And while found primarily in the gay community, certain aspects of the fast track can be also seen among heterosexuals.
Now, the lifestyle hypothesis has been around a while, And the reason, of course, it hasn't really been taken seriously by the medical establishment is there's not really any one thing that you can point to actually work on, to target. And careful epidemiology has now been able to separate some of these things out. So there was obviously a very strong suspicion that these poppers or amyl nitrates were a cause, and I think the good epidemiology work has essentially now ruled that out, because there are aspects of the fast-track gay lifestyle, which include drinking and smoking and various types of sexual activity, that are not correlated with becoming HIV positive and developing AIDS. After all, lots of heterosexuals drink and smoke and do many of the same fast-tracky kind of things that gay men do, and yet they're not dropping dead of AIDS. So there has to be more careful look at the epidemiology to get past the lifestyle label. Because to many, of course, that's seen as a homophobic condemnation of a whole lifestyle that's not actually scientifically or medically supported. We have to look at the individual aspects of lifestyle. Is there one of these lifestyle factors, gonorrhea, syphilis, tanning salons, poppers, that is far more associated with both becoming HIV positive and then later dying? And the answer is yes. Syphilis has been correlated as the most prominent prior condition associated with becoming HIV positive more than any other single condition, and this was proven by a large US Army study conducted and published in 1992, which showed you were 40 times more likely to become HIV positive if you had syphilis than if you hadn't. A similar study in Amsterdam showed the same thing.
Dr. Stephen Chiesa started his private practice in Manhattan in 1982, primarily treating gay men. Chiesa quickly noticed an increase in the number of cases of gonorrhea and herpes, while seeing a relatively small level of cases of syphilis by comparison. He found the low incidence of syphilis among his patients very odd, considering their lifestyle. This is an excerpt from an interview I did with Dr. Chiesa on my radio show around 1990.
After working for several years with these patients, there was something more than a single entity disease going on. The dogma was one cause, one disease, ultimately one magic bullet. And in my experience, and again from 82 to the present day, I've for all practical purposes done nothing but AIDS, I felt that can't be. How could a simple virus, which I believe has only 9 genes, I could be wrong on that, cause such a variety of clinical illnesses? I then began looking for co-infections. The one I came up with, which seems to be the most important and even more important in terms of initially suppressing your immune system than HIV, is of all things syphilis. Now, why then don't we see more syphilis is the obvious question. The answer is we do see it. We're seeing it every day. We're having a true pandemic of syphilis. But because of the presence of HIV, the blood tests that we doctors grew up to believe in don't work. I've been taking all my HIV positive patients, and whether I can find serologic, that is blood evidence of syphilis or not, I'm treating them for syphilis in a rather aggressive way. And quite frankly, I, and apparently no one else, can explain the results I'm getting given orthodox dogma.
So what you're saying is that AIDS as a single virus simply does not exist.
AIDS is a complex disease caused, and state of the art knowledge, and this may change, certainly syphilis, chronic syphilis you don't know you have, that's been on board minimum a year, okay? That's probably 70% of the ball game right there. But you add to that things like, and you made this point very well, Gary, you add herpes to that, and we now know herpes is playing a role in this. It's a 10% role, but 10% is still 10%. HIV is certainly playing a role in this. Again, it's a 10, 15% role, but still 10, 15%. There may be other things, chlamydia, amoebiasis, lifestyle. Every 10% is going to count, but it does seem to be quite clear now that if you hit the patient hard and early, I have to emphasize that I can't put together a train wreck. You gotta come early. But if I can get my hands on an infected, but essentially healthy person early, that person will plateau and live a normal life.
Since the official discovery of the AIDS virus in 1984, we've been told that HIV, the virus that is supposed to cause AIDS, is sexually transmitted, and that everyone who was sexually active was at risk.
The risk reduction results remain positive and significant for drug users, for heterosexual populations, and for gay men.
Although the science of AIDS is still very much up in the air, the early work done by the Centers for Disease Control epidemiologists, now I'm talking about the early 1980s, 81, 82, in my view, pretty much proved that something that was passed on from through sexual activities was decimating the immune systems of the people who were engaging in these activities. And there has been no evidence that has come along since then to basically dissuade me or my colleagues from that view.
The statistics have been confirmed over and over again, most recently just last year from the University of California at San Francisco, that it takes, on average, 1,000 sexual contacts with an HIV person or persons in order to become HIV positive yourself.